Hello, Vital Sign. Today we're going to talk about the modular product of graphs. The modular product of graphs is a binary graph operation. It takes as its input two undirected graphs G and H and outputs an undirected graph known as the modular product of G and H, whose vertex set is the Cartesian product of the vertex sets of the input graphs and whose vertices are connected according to two adjacency rules. The first rule is a pair of vertices uv and u prime v prime in the modular product are adjacent when both their left and right entries are distinct and adjacent in their respective graphs. The second rule is a pair of vertices uv and u prime v prime are adjacent when both their left and right entries are distinct, not adjacent vertices in their respective graphs. Let's work through three examples now to get the hang of this product. First, what is the modular product of these two graphs? Well, remember that the vertex set of the modular product is the Cartesian product of the vertex set of the factor graphs, giving us this as our vertex set. Now let's take the adjacencies one vertex at a time, with the adjacency rules in the bottom right-hand corner to help us out. According to the first rule, vertex A1 will connect to any vertex with both distinct left entry adjacent to vertex A in graph G and distinct right entry adjacent to vertex 1 in graph H. In this case, there is only a single vertex adjacent to A in graph G. That would be vertex B. And there is only a single vertex adjacent to vertex 1 in graph H. That would be vertex 2. Therefore, vertex A1 is adjacent to vertex B2. According to the second adjacency rule, vertex A1 is adjacent to any vertex with both distinct left entry not adjacent to vertex A and distinct right entry not adjacent to vertex 1. In this case, vertex C is not adjacent to vertex A, and vertex 3 is not adjacent to vertex 1. Therefore, vertex A1 is adjacent to vertex C3. These are all of the adjacencies for A1. Let's move on to A2. By the first rule, A2 is adjacent to any vertex with both distinct left entry adjacent to vertex A and distinct right entry adjacent to vertex 2. That means A2 is adjacent to vertices B1 and B3. By the second rule, vertex A2 is adjacent to any vertex with both distinct left entry not adjacent to vertex A and distinct right entry not adjacent to vertex 2. However, there is no vertex in the modular product with distinct right entry not adjacent to 2, because vertex 2 happens to be adjacent to every other vertex in the right graph, H. Therefore, the second rule will not produce any more adjacencies for vertex A2. We can move on to A3 now, going a little quicker. By the first rule, vertex A3 is adjacent to vertex B2. As vertex B is adjacent to vertex A, and vertex 2 is adjacent to vertex 3. By the second rule, A3 is adjacent to C1, as C is not adjacent to A in graph G, and 3 is not adjacent to 1 in graph H. On to B1. By the first rule, B1 is adjacent to A2 and C2. As A and C are adjacent to B in graph G, and 2 is adjacent to 1 in graph H. The second rule does not produce any adjacencies for B1, because in the left graph G, vertex B is adjacent to every other vertex. On to B2. The first rule says that B2 will be adjacent to A1, A3, C1, and C3, as A and C are adjacent to B, and 1 and 3 are adjacent to 2. However, as with B1, There are no adjacencies produced by the second rule for vertex B2. On to vertex B3. By the first rule, B3 is adjacent to A2 and C2. As A and C are adjacent to B, and 2 is adjacent to 3. Again, the second rule will not produce any adjacencies for B3, because vertex B is adjacent to every vertex in graph G. On to the vertices with left entry C. Feel free to pause and try these yourself, and then I'll reveal the answers. By the first rule, C1 is adjacent to B2. By the second rule, C1 is adjacent to A3. By the first rule, C2 is adjacent to B1 and B3. The second rule does not produce any adjacencies for C2, because the right entry of C2 is adjacent to all possible distinct right entries. By the first rule, C3 is adjacent to B2. And by the second rule, C3 is adjacent to A1. We're done. This is the modular product of G and H. Notice that if you have a vertex, UV, in the modular product, where either U, V, or both U and V are adjacent to every vertex in their respective factor graphs, the second rule will not produce any adjacencies for that vertex UV. C2 is an example of this. Also, if you have a vertex UV in the modular product, where either U, V, or both U and V are not adjacent to every vertex in their respective factor graphs, that is, if either U or V are isolated vertices, the first adjacency rule will not produce any adjacencies for that vertex UV. We'll see this come into play in our next example. What is the modular product of these two graphs? First, find the vertex set, which is the Cartesian product of the vertex sets of G and of H. Then, let's find all the edges from the first adjacency rule. We're looking for pairs of vertices whose left and right entries are distinct and adjacent in their respective graphs. But hang on. Both vertices from graph H are isolated. There are no adjacencies in graph H, which means that there are no edges derived from the first adjacency rule. Now let's determine which edges derive from the second adjacency rule. What we're looking for now is pairs of vertices in the modular product whose left entries are distinct and not adjacent in G, and whose right entries are distinct and not adjacent in H. Since vertex A is adjacent to every other vertex in graph G, any vertex in our modular product with left entry A will have no adjacencies resulting from the second adjacency rule. Moving on, we can find some pairs of vertices in our modular product that satisfy that second adjacency rule. I encourage you to pause the video and find these pairs yourself. Here they are. As our final example, let's take the modular product of the complements of the previous two graphs, and let's call these complements G prime and H prime. Again, first, find the vertex set. Next, look at the first adjacency rule. Which pairs of vertices have distinct left and distinct right entries that are both adjacent in their respective graphs? In this case, since vertex A is not adjacent to any other vertex in graph G, no vertex with left entry A will have any edges resulting from the first adjacency rule. On the other hand, B, C, and D are mutually adjacent in graph G, and 1 and 2 are adjacent in graph H, so we will have plenty of edges to draw in according to our first adjacency rule. I encourage you to pause the video and find these yourself. Here they are. Now for the second adjacency rule. What pairs of vertices in our modular product have distinct left and distinct right entries that are both not adjacent in their respective graphs? In this case, there are no such pairs. Why? Because in the right graph, H, every vertex is adjacent to every other vertex. So we're finished. Surprisingly, this is the same graph as before when we took the modular product of the complements of these factor graphs. This leads us into the first of two special properties of the modular product that we'll cover in this video. The modular product of G and H is the same as the modular product of the complement of G with the complement of H. The reason for this is that obviously the vertex sets are the same, and if any two vertices in the modular product of G and H are adjacent, then that means either their left and right entries are distinct and both adjacent in their respective graphs, or their left and right entries are distinct and not adjacent in their respective graphs. Regardless, when we take the complement of both factor graphs, U and U prime and V and V prime are still distinct, and they are still either both adjacent or both not adjacent in their respective graphs, the opposite of whichever one they were in the original graph. This means that UV and U prime V prime are still adjacent vertices in the modular product of the complement of G with the complement of H. Intuitively, since complementation only flips the adjacencies, and since the modular product requires the left and right entries to be distinct and have the same adjacency relation between each other, as long as we complement both factor graphs, the resulting product will be the same. Another interesting property of the modular product is that every clique in the modular product of two graphs G and H corresponds to an isomorphism between some vertex-induced subgraph of G and some vertex-induced subgraph of H. The reason for this comes from the adjacency rules of the modular product, displayed in the top left. Suppose we have some N clique in our modular product, consisting of U sub 1, V sub 1, U sub 2, V sub 2, and so on, up to U sub N, V sub N. Then consider the subgraph, U, of graph G, induced by vertices U sub 1 through U sub N. And consider the subgraph W of graph H, induced by vertices V sub 1 through V sub N. Next, we can define a function F from the vertex set of U to the vertex set of W, where f of little u sub I equals little v sub I. Essentially, it maps u sub 1 to v sub 1, u sub 2 to v sub 2, and so on. Notice that this function is a bijection, and that if some distinct u sub I and u sub k are adjacent in graph U, then f of u sub I and f of u sub k are adjacent in graph W. And that if some distinct u sub I and u sub k are not adjacent in graph U, then f of u sub I and f of u sub k are not adjacent in graph W. The reason for this is that these vertices are coming from a clique in the modular product. That means that u sub I and u sub k are the distinct left entries of the vertices u sub I, v sub I, and u sub k, v sub k, where these vertices are adjacent in the modular product since they are both in the same clique. Then that also means that either U sub I is adjacent to U sub K and V sub I is adjacent to V sub K, or U sub I is not adjacent to U sub K and V sub I is not adjacent to V sub K. Regardless, the relationship between U sub I and U sub K must be the same as that between V sub I and V sub K, allowing us to make these inferences. Since we defined our F of U sub I to be V sub I, then that means that whenever some U sub I is adjacent to U sub K in U, their images are adjacent in W. And whenever some U sub I is not adjacent to U sub K in U, their images are not adjacent in W. What we have just shown is that there exists an isomorphism from the subgraph induced by the vertices U sub 1 through U sub N in graph G to the subgraph induced by the vertices v sub 1 through v sub n in graph H. From this, we can conclude that any clique in a modular product of two graphs corresponds to an isomorphism between subgraphs of those two graphs. In fact, a clique of size n in a modular product corresponds to an isomorphism between subgraphs with n vertices. This is an amazing fact because it lets us turn the problem of counting the number of subgraph isomorphisms between two graphs into a problem of counting the number of cliques in their modular product. Returning to our second example, we can count 6-2 cliques in this modular product, namely the edges of the graph, which means that there are 6 isomorphisms between subgraphs with 2 vertices in graph G and H. Here they are. That's it for this video. In the future, we'll take a look at Shannon capacity and homomorphisms, isomorphisms, and automorphisms within graph theory. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe, like, share, and comment if you liked the video. Have a great day.